Hello everyone, I am Rajeshwari Moganti, professor from Department of Biochemistry, AIIMS, New Delhi. The topic today we are going to do is on the non-covalent interactions, van der Waals forces, bond energies, bond angles, Bayes strength and weak interactions. Okay. Now in the previous chapter you have studied, previous module, you studied the covalent bonds and other chemical bonds. But here we will be studying mostly the non-covalent interactions. Now there are two kinds of forces attraction that operate in any molecule, intramolecular and intramolecular. So the intramolecular forces operate within the molecule, same molecule as the name suggests, and also holds two individual molecules together. For example, covalent bond which has been covered in the previous module. Whereas intermolecular forces operates between molecules, between in this one molecule and a neighboring molecule, for example water and this and any solute in the system, in the solution. So the difference between these three states of the matter, that is solid, liquid and gases, is actually based on a competition between the strength of the intermolecular bonds with and the thermal energy of the system. So the intermolecular forces actually play very, very important role, and these forces are almost experiences by the all molecules, everything. And although some of them are actually weak forces in some cases, suppose for example you take the hydrogen gas, if you cool down the molecules stick together to form a liquid, and then of course solid due to the intermolecular forces of attraction between these molecules. So this intermolecular forces of attraction is so weak that the hydrogen gas has to be cooled at 21 degrees Kelvin, that is actually temperature, if you do the degrees Celsius, it will be minus 252 degrees centigrade. Therefore, even in helium, for example, the intermolecular attractions are also very weak. So it takes the temperature drops to 4 Kelvin, which is again minus 273, and which is actually minus 269, minus 273 the 0 degree. Okay. So if it is very important and to understand what kind of natural molecular interactions are taking place and at different temperatures, and therefore we will be studying these in more detail. Now based on this introduction or the topic, the objectives have been laid out. The first one is that at the end of this topic you should be able to understand what are the intermolecular forces, what are the molecular interactions, and why do we have to study, what is their significance. Now similarly, you have also should be able to explain the formation of different types of bonds, the basis of the bond order, bond energy and so on, and also understand what is Bayes strain theory. So we will do all these in this module. Now, intermolecular forces are actually the forces which molecules attract with each other, and therefore these forces are weaker than ionic or covalent bond which you studied in the previous module. Okay. So the different types of forces, non-covalent interactions, which include van der Waals forces, which also includes dipole-dipole forces, dipole-induced dipole forces, hydrogen bonding and dispersion forces. Now these dispersion forces also are called London forces. So now we will do all these in one by one. Okay. Now the dipole-dipole forces, as the name suggests, that it is actually between two dipolar molecules. They possess, each molecule possesses a permanent dipole, that is important in this aspect. They have a permanent dipole in on each of them, and therefore there is a, when there is a permanent dipole, there is a partial charge that is present, delta, which is of course less than that of the electronic charge. And therefore the dipole-dipole interaction, there is always a partially negative portion of one of the polar molecule is attracted to the neighboring molecule which is partially positive. Okay. So I mean, which is the next molecule which has a positive charge, partially charged molecule. So the two types of interactions account for the, for example of the elevation of the boiling water, elevation of the boiling point of the water, because water molecules interact with each other and therefore the temperature goes up for the boiling. Now there are number of examples which are given for you on the screen. Now the electron cloud distribution in these dipole-dipole hydrogen, for example the hydrogen chloride is shown. Similarly the dipole-dipole interaction between two hydrogen chloride molecules is also given. Okay, now because both HCl has a charge molecule, it is a charge per proton and chloride ions. Okay, so these interactions actually are stronger than London forces. London forces are weak dispersion forces and decrease with increase of the distance between the two dipoles. So the interaction or the energy is inversely proportional to the square of the distance between these two. Now the dipole-dipole interaction energy between the stationary of one polar molecule is proportional to 1 by R3, where R is the distance between the polar molecules. So the dipole-dipole interaction energy between stationary polar molecule is proportional to the 1 by R3, that is R is a distance. But between the two polar molecules which are in motion, then the proportionality is different, where 1 by R to the power 6, where R is the distance between the two polar molecules. So the next one is the dipole induced dipole forces. So here it is, one of them is stationary and the other one is an induced one. So the dipole and induced dipole actually operate between polar molecules surrounded by an electrostatic field and nearby the molecules lacking the permanent dipole. So the electrostatic field in the polar molecule shifts the electron density in the nearby molecule so as to cause a polarization in the electrically neutral molecule. So it is an induced dipole. The molecule is inducing the dipole in a neighboring molecule. For example, if you take a phenylalanine or a tryptophan which have pi electrons, amino acids, which are polarizable but compared to isoleucine which has no pi electrons. Okay, so the interaction energy between the polar molecule having permanent dipole and the molecule lacking the permanent dipole is proportional to 1 by r to the power 6, like in case of the earlier one we talked about, where r is exactly the distance between the two molecules. Okay, now the next one is the dispersion forces. That is the London dispersion. These are actually first proposed by the scientist Fridge London. That's why it is called London dispersion forces. And these are actually the weakest of all of them between the two intermolecular forces. They exist actually almost all types of molecules, whether ionic molecule or a covalent molecule or a polar molecule or a nonpolar molecule. Therefore, there is a momentary dipole developed in electrically symmetrical atoms or the nonpolar molecules, and actually they have no permanent dipole moment. So these molecules actually in each other they interact with each other and they have oscillating dipoles. So the strength of these London dispersion forces actually depends on the electrons per molecule and the polarizability of the two molecules. So the London dispersion forces actually result in a higher boiling point for the bromine. So the resultingly what happens is instantaneous dipole lives for a very short time and does not require actually much energy for breaking these London dispersion forces, and that's the reason why these nonpolar covalent compounds, like if you take methane or oxygen or any nitrogen, they freeze at a very very low temperatures. So the interaction energy in London dispersion forces is inversely proportional to the 6th power of the distance between the two interacting particles. Therefore, 1 by r to the power 6, where r is of course the distance between the two particles. Now, these forces are important only at a short distances, for example, 500 picometers. So, that's a very, very short, and that's why they are very weak also. So, the next comes is the most important, hydrogen bond. Now, this is a special case of dipole-dipole interaction. But this is found in the molecules that occur specifically between hydrogen atoms. So one has to be hydrogen atom bonded to either an oxygen or a nitrogen or a fluorine atom. For example, it could be NH, OH or HF bonds which actually can have. And although the hydrogen bonding is regarded as limited to NOH, there are species such as chlorine may also participate in hydrogen bonding. Okay. Although for compared to the conventional approach, it is considered, but of course they are very less. So the energy is about 110 to 100 kilojoules of hydrogen bond, and this explains why there is a high boiling point or a melting point of water, and then hydrogen compared to the hydrogen fluoride or the hydrogen bonding therefore determines and gives the structure and properties of many compounds and plays an important role in the biology. It's a very, very important, hydrogen bond is a very important property. They also hold, bonds are present in the proteins and also between the CO and NH groups, nucleic acids, and interaction between electronegative atom of one molecule to hydrogen atom and so on. So the examples are plethora of examples in biology. Now there are examples which are shown to you in the diagram, that interaction between the hydrogen bonds between A and T in DNA, or a G and C, guanine and cytosine in DNA, and so on and so forth. Now here I want to make a difference between intermolecular forces and thermal interactions. So the energy comes from the motion of its constituent atoms or the molecules, is what we call it as thermal energy. Now the thermal energy is actually dependent on the temperature of the substances, and it that is responsible for the thermal motion or the average kinetic energy of the particle or the matter that tend to keep the molecules keeping separate. But there are three states of the matter that result the balance between intermolecular force and the thermal energy of the molecule. Now, for example, when the thermal energy is reduced, that means energy is reduced by lowering the temperature, for example, the molecular interactions become stronger and molecules come together to make a liquid or a solid, and that's what happens. And although the compression, if you do see, look at the compression, they bring the molecule closer and maximize the intermolecular forces. But gases actually liquefy only when the thermal energy of the molecule is reduced to lower than the temperature. Now the relation between the thermal energy and intermolecular interactions in the three states of matter is actually shown to you in the next slide. Now the what are the significance of these intermolecular forces? For example, most important is in the protein. When a protein folds, it forms a lot of intermolecular forces. Van der Waals interaction play a lot of role in stabilizing the protein structure. Also in the coiled and protein coiled, that is native, and the random coil or the open structure protein, there is an interaction between the side chains and the, for example, in the alpha helix, beta sheet and so on. And hydrophobic forces are also present, like in presence of the leucine and so on, where the nonpolar molecule, nonpolar amino acids are present. Now the non-biological thing like graphene also shows lot of weak bondings, and therefore they also are present in the non-biological systems. Now for example, if you take any polymeric chains are cross-linked by the van der Waals forces, they also get very stable. Now the van der Waals forces are also used in sometimes the, you know, molecule, the animals which climb. It's not only the small molecule, but they also play important role when you're walking on a water or an animal climbing and so on and so forth. So the number of examples are many, but without knowing that those forces are actually they are taking place or operating. Now let us look at the bond angles and bond energies. What do you mean by a chemical bond which is formed between the atoms? They transfer or share of electrons to achieve a stable octet. Okay, now a bond will form if the energy of the total molecule that is formed is lower than that of the separated atoms, otherwise there won't be any bond, right? So therefore the bonding, the way atoms attract to each other, is what actually makes the molecule to form, and that is why all of the chemical properties explains the based on this property. Now the important parameters associated with these chemical bonds, like bond length, bond angle, bond enthalpy, they have significant effect on the properties of these compounds. Now let's see first the bond length. Now what is a bond length? Now the bond length is the average distance between two bonded atoms. Now when you take the distance, that is actually the distance or distance of the minimum potential energy, and also a number of electrons between the two nuclei increases, the bonds become shorter and stronger. Now if there are triple bond, they are shorter and therefore stronger than the double bond, and similarly the double bonds are stronger than the single bond because there is a bond distance is shorter. The next thing is the bond energy. It is the energy that is required to break a bond, or the heat that is released or absorbed during a chemical chain that is due to the differences between the bond energies of reactant and a product. So when a molecule is formed, so therefore it gives information about the strength of the bonding interaction. Therefore the energy required to break bond is endothermic, while the energy is released on the bond formation is exothermic. But the bond energy is mathematically can also be expressed. The energy equation that is shown here between the bond broken and the bond, difference between the bonds broken and the bonds formed. For example, if we take a pair of atoms, okay, a higher bond order results in a shorter bond length and higher energy. Or for a given pair of atoms, a shorter bond is formed is a stronger bond. So this is very simple and understandable. Now the bond length increases if you go by down the group in a periodic table, and bond length decreases across the periodic table. So similarly, the bond energy is also shows the a kind of trend. Now I have given one a small numerical here. What you can do is to pause the video what you are watching right now after the exam, after the numerical is given, and do your numerical, come back and then check the answer with whatever is given. So the answer is given, but I request you not to see the answer right now, and then come back and go and see whether you have done the correct answer or not. Now to explain the shape of the atom, the bond angle actually determines the shape around any atom bonded to two other atoms. For example, the VSE pair model, that is which is covered actually in the previous module, but I would just simplify it here just give a refreshment, refresh the knowledge. The what does it say actually? The number one, the two electron pairs in the valence orbital are arranged linearly, that is number one. And the second one is that the three electron pairs are organized in a trigonal planar arrangement, that is if there are three electron pairs. And the third one is if there are four electron pairs, they are arranged in a tetrahedral arrangement. So these are the formats that actually the when the molecule is formed, they follow the shape of the, they give the shape of the molecule. Now if there are five electron pairs that are arranged, they form a trigonal bipyramid. And if there are six electron pairs that are organized, and what will be the shape? That will lead to an octahedral arrangement. So if the non-bonding electron pairs are as important as the bonding electron pairs in determining the structure, and the non-bonding electrons in the valence shell take up more space than the bonding electrons. So the bonding angles actually, bonding angles decrease as the number of non-bonding electrons pairs increases, okay. So the repulsive interaction obviously of the electron pairs decreases. And how does it decrease? If you have a lone pair, which is greater compared to lone pair, bond pair, and which is greater than bond pair electrons. So these angles and the geometry of these number of the groups surrounding a particular atom are actually explains the are explained by the valence shell electron pair repulsion or the VSE pair theory. So now we have studied the intermolecular forces, bond angles, bond energy. Now I would like to summarize the gist of the module. The intermolecular forces differ from the pure electrostatic forces that you have to remember, like an ionic bond that exists between two oppositely charged ions, and they do not include forces that hold atoms of a covalent molecule. That's very important. And the second one is intermolecular forces cause attraction between molecules. Now these forces are weaker than the ionic and covalent bonds, and therefore are very responsible, they are responsible for physical state of any compound, whether it exists in a solid state or a liquid state or a gaseous state. Okay. Now the third one is that intermolecular forces, when we say, they include a number of them, that one of them is van der Waals forces, dipole-dipole interactions, then you have dipole and induced dipole, then you have London dispersion forces and hydrogen bonds. Now these all of them play together at the simultaneously. For example, very important in protein folding, any polymer formation or any kind of this, for example, walking on a surface, water surface, and that is a general lifetime in example. Now these atoms are transfer the electrons to each to form a, the main purpose is to form a octet so that it can be in a, I mean it can reach inert state. Now we explained, talked about the bond lengths, bond energy, bond enthalpy. They also have significant effect, role on their characteristics of the compounds. Now the, for example, the bond length is average distance between the two bonded atoms, that is the distance between the minimum potential energy when the, those two atoms are staying in a minimum potential energy state. Now for a given pair of atoms, I told you that higher bond order results in a higher, shorter bond length and therefore higher bond energy. Now the last one is the Bayer postulated that if you take example in cycloalkanes, they possess different amounts of strain and stability. Therefore, depending on the size of the ring, they have different kinds of structures. He also concluded that the strain exists in 3 or 4 membered rings. And the rings of 6 and more atoms, containing 6 or more atoms. So, the strain increasing with the size of the ring. So, these are the basic fundamentals of included in this module, that is intermolecular forces. Thank you.